guys, it's Roz here, and this is another panel from my Toronto Comic Con 2017 experience. This is going to be the Robert Picardo panel. He's most well known for playing the Doctor on Star Trek Voyager, which happens to be one of my favorite Star Treks, if not my favorite. I absolutely love Janeway. So to have gone to see him in a panel was really exciting. He had some great anecdotes, and he's just a really funny guy. Like, you guys will see in this panel that he's just really funny, comes out of nowhere with some great zingers. He's done a lot of other things. He also mentions in the panel, he talks about having worked on Stargate. There were some great questions thrown at him, and I think he was a really good sport in answering all of them. So if you guys enjoy Robert Picardo, if you like Star Trek, if you're interested in all of that, then make sure to check out this video. So let's hand it on over to Robert Picardo.
Introduce myself. My name is John Kirk. I'm a writer and reviewer for popmythology.com and trekcore.com and Back Issue, and I've got the great honor of being your moderator tonight. So, before we begin, Bob, I believe that I have a few trivia facts about you that people might not know about.
Oh my God! So. Twin periods.
Double your punch.
That's clout.
I feel refreshed already. So you attended Yale, and ironically, you actually were pre-med.
I wanted to be a doctor. That was my childhood ambition. I probably was thinking about being a pediatrician. I think this, I remembered my own childhood baby doctor, and he was a very impressive guy. So I went off to Yale. I had taken advanced biology, I guess, in high school, and I was a biology major for about a year and a half, but I would try to do plays at the same time, which was very hard to do because we had those lengthy labs at the end of the day. And then you went straight to rehearsal, and you had no time to study, ever. I wasn't going to make it to med school and do theater as much as I wanted to. So I was in a kind of a dilemma because theater had always been my hobby. And then I was in a production at Yale that kind of got a lot of attention, and that's what turned my head around. A young graduate of the Yale School of Music, who's gone on to be a very successful conductor, John Losseri, had worked with Leonard Bernstein conducting, I guess, the choir or the choral work for a recent revival of the opera Carmen. And he said to Mr. Bernstein, I think they screwed up your, Len Bernstein wrote a show called The Mass. And it opened the Kennedy Center in Washington in like 1970. So this young upstart conductor in his 20s says, I think they screwed up your show, maestro. I'd like to try it. Do it at Yale, and he gave him the first non-professional rights to the show. And Bernstein liked our production so much, he took us to Vienna. So at 19 years old, I went off to Vienna to perform this, in the spring after my second year at Yale. But when we did it at Yale, Bernstein, who called me the Great Picardo, was making fun of the Great Caruso, which is a movie. Believe me, my singing voice nowhere deserves being called the Great Picardo. But he said, what are you going to do with your life? And I said, I'm going to be a doctor. He said, oh, I'm surprised to hear that. I thought you'd want to be a performer. You have such great natural energy on stage, not phony Broadway energy. And I said to him, would you tell my mother? So in the opening night party, Leonard Bernstein told my mother. That's what sprung me out of pre-med, folks.
So you did actually go on and do some further music. You have a CD with a Faraday album and
other
singers we've seen on the episode.
I have done numerous CDs, probably more than you wanted me. But song parodies, writing, what's it called? When you steal lyrics, felking. Felking? You gotta be careful because there's another word that you don't want to say. I always do this before. What is it called? Filking. How embarrassing for me. Anyway, yes, we write funny lyrics to it, so that's always been a hobby. And I've done some singing. I just did on the Star Trek cruise. Did you guys hear about the Star Trek cruise?
Yeah.
I did my first sort of old style cruise show where you do comedy patter and you sing songs. Because I have a lifelong friend who performs on cruise ships all the time. So when I went to the cruise company and I said, I don't think you have any other Star Trek celebrities who have a good friend who does this all the time. I said, why don't we write a show for you? And we did, and it went over really, really, really well. So well that they booked us for the next two cruises. So if you ever go on a Star Trek cruise, you'll see me do some more singing, quite a bit. I think we opened the show with the lyrics to the Star Trek theme. Did you know the Star Trek theme has lyrics? And you probably never heard them, and you know why? Because they stink. Really, really terrible. Gene Roddenberry wrote the lyrics just to get after royalties, knowing that they would never be heard. But anyway, I opened by singing the lyrics to the Star Trek, the original Star Trek theme.
So take us back to your audition for the Doctor. How did that go down?
I was doing a play at the time at a very prestigious theater in downtown Los Angeles called the Mark Taper Forum. I'd always wanted to work there. And I spent, early in my career, I did two leads on Broadway, so I was fairly accomplished when I first came to LA in theater. I did work at a number of the theaters around LA, but I'd never worked at the Mark Taper, so I finally got a job there the summer of 1995. And we're just about to open, and I am curiously playing a doctor with a terrible bedside manner. In a play, what was the play called? Waiting Room. And I think we were in Tech Week. In Tech Week, the rehearsal days are long because you're setting all the lights and all of the actors are getting used to the set, all these things. And on one of my tech days, my agent sent me a script for Voyager and said, can you do an audition during your lunch break? And I said, well, I can't do this pilot because I'm performing. And he said, don't tell them that. So agents are great teaching you how to lie. So I went and auditioned, but when I read the script, I'd gotten the script a couple days before, and I said to him, I don't know if I can do it, but I read the script. And I ended up going on my meal break on a 12-hour workday. You know, we had a 2-hour break, and we work 5 hours, get a 2-hour break, and come back for 5 more hours. So that's a hard thing to do anyway. A lot of the actors take naps and whatever. So I ran off and did the audition. But before I said yes to the audition, I had read just the lines for the doctor's character, and it said, a computer program of a doctor, a hologram who is a computer program of a doctor, colorless, humorless. Does that sound like a bucket of fun for you? I mean, literally, there were 9 lines, and the lines weren't funny. And I kept thinking, a hologram, how does he grab medical instruments? Don't they go through his hands? I didn't understand enough about, the holodeck, that excuse they have for objects to feel real on the holodeck, because you're converting matter into energy and whatever. So I threw it on the floor and said, they're never gonna put me in a Star Trek series. And I called a friend of mine, an actress who was auditioning for Janeway, she guest starred. We were good friends, she was in China Beach with me, her name is Megan Gallagher. And Megan had been in Deep Space Nine at that point, I think twice, and said, oh, the writing is great, you have to read the script. And she said, there's another character called Neelix that looks like fun. So I read Neelix and I thought it was delightful. And I had my agent call and say he doesn't want to read for the doctor, he wants to read for this Neelix character. Meanwhile, I understand that Neelix is in makeup, but I think it's going to be little rubber ear tips like the Spock guy. And when you ask them, during Star Trek series, your agent asks, how long will the makeup process take? They say, we'll get back to you. And when they call back, they say, more than 15 minutes. Which is true, 3.5 hours is more than 15 minutes. Every day for 7 years. But I went and tested Cornelius. I made my peace with being buried in makeup, and I went and tested. I didn't know my competition was Ethan Phillips, who's a dear old friend of mine. I just went, they had a special time, I think they arranged for me, and I read, and they loved me as Felix, and I tested for Felix. And I almost got that part, and I thank God. The story I heard is actually that the producers wanted me in the network, that they had a new the studio in the network. The producers of the show were leaning toward me and the network and the new Paramount Television. Because, you know, when you audition, there's 18 people in the room. You know what they all do. You got the four producers of Star Trek, but they have all these studio people and, you know, the new United Paramount Network, which is since gone. See, there's a lot of people in the room. Anyway, I didn't get the part, and I thought, okay, it wasn't meant to be. But then they called back. They called my agent and said, we really would love to see him read for the part we originally asked for. Doctor. And I literally said to my agent, I don't get the joke, but I'll go in and try. So I went in, and I knew they were looking for someone funny. I heard that they'd seen 900 actors from Howard Essman. They'd seen every actor. They'd seen a lot of comedians, I think. And I kept thinking, how is it funny if he's colorless and humorless? But I went in, I read, and I did something you never do on a Star Trek in my audition. I ad-libbed.
We don't have to live on Star Trek.
I mean, I just thought I'm going to make them laugh. So the casting director, now you probably know this, that all of Star Trek has the same casting director, Junie Lowry Johnson. You've seen her name a million times. But Nan Dutton, a different casting director, cast Voyager because Julie had just had babies. Junie had just had twin babies. So Nan did the original casting of Voyager. She was exhausted. And you looked at this woman's face and you could see the words, I wish I had never taken this job. when I read with her, one of the doctor's few scripted lines in the pilot was, I scan. Oh, there was the line where I say, medical tricorder, with a very stern look, and they laughed at that. And then I'm supposed to scan. I'm scanning the casting director, Nan, in front of me, saying, and the line is, your injuries are not serious. You can return to your station. And I scanned Nan Dutton, who looked exhausted and miserable, and I said, your injuries are not serious. You can return to casting. My audition. I completely broke the fourth wall and said that. She laughed. She would look at me like, what? And then broke in laughter. And then I had a couple more lines. The last line that was scripted was, the doctor is left alone in sick bay and no one's there. And he says, I believe someone has failed to terminate my program, right? Yeah. And I took a long deadpan look at all the people that I was auditioning for, and I said, I'm a doctor, not a knife light. So when I met Pete Kelly, I told him, I said, you know, I was channeling D. Kelly, but I didn't know I was ripping him off, because it hadn't occurred to me that that was a classic doctorism. I didn't know what I was doing. It was like fate. But when I met D within a year, and I said, my character pays homage to you all the time, he goes, ah, you mean you steal from me? And I went, yeah, pretty much.
Explain that, I mean, Star Trek's brought so much to everybody, but what is it that it's brought to your life?
You know, yeah, because it's obviously it's brought me this. Mm-hmm. It's brought me a group of loyal people who love my work on Star Trek enough to watch me in other things, which is great. I mean, some of the audience members, the China Beach band back there, probably knew me before Voyager. When I had hair, remember I had hair? That was not my hair at the time. There was the cowboy in her space. I had hair in that too. Tiny. By the way, if you're going to wear a hairpiece, I don't recommend you do it in a television series featuring a helicopter. Tiny Beach, I wore, you know, I had a $2,500 hairpiece glued to my head right under a helicopter. Like the old watch commercials where the guy dives off the cliff, holding the Timex watch. So It's brought me a signature role, which every actor loves having in their career, where people around the world, you know, I can go to other countries and they know me from Star Trek, which is a great, I think, a great honor to have reached an audience that's global. And I don't think I ever really would have done that without Star Trek in my life. And I love to travel, so I get to go to all sorts of cool places. You know, I was in Milan, Italy, at a convention, you know, 2 weeks ago. And then last week, I was at South by Southwest, which is totally cool, but not for Star Trek. I went because our fearless leader of the Planetary Society, Bill Nye, has a documentary that opened about him last week, which was totally cool. You see my Science is Universal shirt? Let me show you. But really, I guess, you know what, I would say that the thing in Star Trek that I didn't expect, I mean, I knew that Star Trek had these loyal fan bases, that there would be convention opportunities and opportunities to travel and meet fans everywhere, but I didn't really think when I got the role that I would have this opportunity to meet so many people in science, technology, exploration, engineering, so many of the real people that are doing the things in our present day that we only make believe we're doing as actors on Star Trek. I sat on stage with five men who walked on the moon at the 30th anniversary in Huntsville, Alabama. I've been in the control room a couple of times for the Mars rovers at Jet Propulsion Laboratory. I hang out with these guys. I'm friends with the software guy, Mohawk Man, if you ever watched, the first data we were getting from the Curiosity rover, the updates were given by a guy named Robert Picardo, who is who has a bleached mohawk, and President Obama referred to him when he saw the video of all the guys cheering when the rover landed safely. Obama said, boy, those engineers, they don't look like they used to, you know. And who's that Mohawk guy there? So he became Mohawk guy. So I met a lot of cool people, and it's that has been most surprising because of Star Trek, what it's brought to my life. And we talked about how I was a biology major. I love science. I grew up loving science, particularly life science. I can't say honestly that I was a space enthusiast or space fan when I was, you know, back in the 60s, although of course I was glued to the TV for the moon landing and all of the early missions. But in between those landmark events, I didn't dream of going into space myself. But it's kind of come full circle, because now that we have all this tantalizing evidence of possibly discovering life, microbial life on Mars, or Mars under the ice in a moon of Jupiter or Europa, or all these cool things, or this amazing announcement about 4 weeks ago where they found
nine exoplanets, is that what you mean?
Yes, nine exoplanets, of which I think is it four of them are in ideal situations. I mean, obviously the red dwarf star is smaller than our sun, so they have to be closer, but they're the right size ratio and the right distance, and they are ideal to have liquid water.
Goldilocks.
Sorry?
Goldilocks zone.
The Goldilocks zone. So there's just so many cool discoveries that are happening right now, and I'm proud that I've been associated now almost 20 years with the world's leading space advocacy nonprofit group, founded by Carl Sagan and two colleagues in 1980, called the Planetary Society. And Bill Nye is our leader now, and Neil deGrasse Tyson was on the board for many years. He recently stepped down because he had other commitments, but we have amazing, you know, I sit at a table with all these astrophysicists and captains of industry. I am the least credentialed person at that table, and really I'm awed and impressed that I'm there. And my mission with the group really is to bring you guys, to bring sci-fi fans, if you haven't already been brought into the real science fold, if you're not a fan of science and the present exploration that we're doing in NASA and ESA and all the space-capable countries around the world, then I'm hoping to get you interested in that. So I do a monthly video newsletter called The Planetary Post, which you can subscribe to for free. My guest star this month is a guy named Tim Russ. I wanted to show it, but we don't have video projection here. But if you search Robert Picardo / Tim Russ, The Planetary Post, you'll get it. Or you just say Robert Picardo, Tim Russ at the Griffith Observatory. If you saw La La Land, they featured the landmark Griffith Observatory in LA. Tim goes there once a month for star party nights because he's an avid astronomer and he owns four scopes himself. So we did a very funny, I'll blow the joke on you guys. We did a thing where I run into Tim there and he doesn't remember who I am. Very convincing. He has no idea who I am. He thinks I'm just a Star Trek fan trying to get an autograph out of him. It's very funny. So I tend to use humor, but I'm really there telling people what's cool and what they can do in their area, you know, that they could, if you have a young person in your family, I think a starter telescope for $90 or $100 is a great gift. Bill Nye says that was the first time he was captivated by the idea of space travel was when he looked through a telescope when he was 7 or 8 years old. So anyway, I hope you guys are fans of not only of Star Trek, but of science as well. Because science needs your help now.
Now, I was speaking of humor though earlier. I was supposed to ask you about a play that you're involved in with Sylvester McCoy called A Joke.
A Joke. We have a Kickstarter. It's not a Kickstarter. We have a campaign, a fundraising campaign. You all know Sylvester McCoy. He's one of the Doctor Who's from the 80s. He and I have become friends, and we're going to act in a play. Now, he's a very accomplished theater actor. He played the fool to Sir Ian McKellen's Lear 8 or 9 years ago. He and another British actor, Richard Oliver, and I will be doing a play this August at the Edinburgh Theatre Festival in Scotland, which is something I wanted to do forever. The whole town is taken over by actors doing plays everywhere, every minute of the day. They have two festivals. They have the Theatre Festival and then the Fringe Festival. And we'll be in the Fringe Festival because, frankly, we're pretty fringy guys. It's a new play. It's about an Englishman. It's sort of like Waiting for Godot. It's three characters in search of a punchline, kind of. It's three characters that find themselves in this mysterious world, and they can't figure out their relationship with each other. But it's quite funny. And there's an Irishman, an Englishman, and a Scotsman. And believe it or not, I'm the Scotsman. it doesn't necessarily mean that I talk like Scotty on Star Trek. I'm of Scottish descent. But it's quite funny, and I'm really looking forward to working with the other two actors and the playwright Dan Freeman. So check out, I've been tweeting about it if you follow me on Twitter, and I know you do. I mean, I hope you do. You'll see some cartoons about our show this August.
At this point, I think that there's a number of questions. Mm-hmm. So let's just open it up to the audience, and if there are any questions right now, let's there's one over there in the corner.
So.
That sounds like a good one.
It has to be Mars, because Mars is the one that we've had our sights on for so long, and with the works of Ray Bradbury and so many others, we kind of dreamed of life on Mars. So I think, and I also believe that Mars should be our next step, that our new administration should support the architecture we have in place, not, you know, keep pursuing, keep the budget on track, give us, you know, 5% increases in the NASA budget every year for the next 5 years, and we can be in orbit around Mars in 2033 and landing by 2037. With the present budget that we have, and just, you know, increases basically for inflation. So I would say Mars, but I am also fascinated by the moons of Jupiter. I also loved I got to meet Alan Stern, the principal investigator of the of the Pluto mission, New Discoveries. That was totally cool. I mean, those are that's probably as big a success story as our first moon landing, because that project almost got shut down so many times, and he had to do it faster, cheaper than ever before to stay on track, because you had only certain launch windows, and he knew that if he didn't, once he got approved, if he didn't get out within that first window that was about 3.5 years away, once they started building the spacecraft, I think 3.5 or 4 years away, the project would probably be canceled. So it's an amazing success story. So I am, but I think, and also we all got captivated by the movie The Martian. I mean, it's really captured the public's imagination too. And he's done Andy. The writer, Andy Weir, who is a great friend of the Planetary Society, has been in many events. And I got to go, they have a forum every year in Washington, D.C. in the spring, and I went last year, the Mars Forum in the spring every year. I won't be able to make it this year, but I'm sure my buddy Bill Nye goes every year. So it's an exciting time. I really think the public is getting engaged again, and I hope that all stays on track, because you know, when you get a new administration and they have other priorities and they start adjusting budgets, you hope that the people will speak up and say, I think exploration is important. I think it's a priority that we need to maintain. Yes, right then.
I was wondering if you could speak to your relationship with Joe Dante, and then maybe if you have a moment, maybe also talk about your experience shooting Back to School with Rodney Dangerfield.
Joe Dante saw me in my first Broadway show. I don't know whether he saw it in New York or he saw it once we remounted it in Los Angeles, where I played the angry young man, son of Jack Lemmon, the famous movie star. Mm-hmm. I was 24 years old when I did it on Broadway. And if I could, you know, wish any young actor anything, it would be to have an experience like that, to work with a great, great star and person, Jack Lemmon. He'd been a movie star for 25 years at the time I met him. He'd been a top box office. He was only 54 years old. China Syndrome hadn't come out yet. He'd won the Oscar twice already, I think, yeah, for Save the Tiger and Mr. Roberts. And he was so gracious to me. So Joe Dante came to see me playing the angry young man, son of Jack Lemmon, and decided I was the werewolf for him, I guess. I don't know how he, but he had me in to read for The Howling. And I remember I was very creepy in The Howling. I always liked horror movies, so it was fun for me to go and audition for one. I wouldn't have picked that necessarily as my first movie, because I'm a very creepy guy, and I have this lengthy transformation scene where I turn into a werewolf that was done all pre-CGI. There was no computer-generated transformations back then. So I had literally, they made a copy of my face in latex, and then they glued under that thin latex copy of my face, they glued these long tubes that I believe were unused condoms. And I never asked. The tubes glued on my head, and the tubes were inflated with little hoses that came out the back of my head, were hidden by the wig, and I had about, I don't know, 8 people off camera with little tubes inflating my face. Crazy. But during the shooting of The Howling, because Joe thought I was principally a dramatic actor, and then during the shooting of The Howling, I just made a lot of jokes in between takes, or when something went wrong, when someone overinflated my shoulder and it exploded. And he decided I was funny, and then he, right after that, asked me to do, I don't know what came next. I think it was Gremlins. He offered me a part in Gremlins, his most successful movie. But it came through my agent. This is why agents are bad sometimes. My agent said, Joe Dunst must want you to be in Gremlins. I went, great, what's the part? He said, well, there really isn't a part. He's going to create it for you. I said, I'm going to be an extra. And I, because of not being able to get questions, I actually said no. And he was mad at me for a while, but that's long ago. And now I say yes to whatever it is. And sometimes the roles are bigger, and sometimes they're not, but they're always fun. But he, you know, I think I've worked with him 10, 12 times now. Last year I was on a Salem episode he directed. We still do it, it's just there's not as many movies now because it's hard to get movies made. But Joe has sold a script about Roger Corman. Roger Corman was the great low-budget film producer that gave Joe his start, gave Francis Coppola, Ron Howard. A million people directed their first movie for Roger Corman in the 60s and early 70s. And I think Bill Hader from Saturday Night Live is going to play Roger Corman, and it's going to be called The Boy with Kaleidoscope Eyes, and I'm hoping to be in that.
yeah, Wolverine.
Kind of a two-part question. Part one, if you had a full budget, like all money that you had, what film would you want to make? And the second part of that question is, who would like you want to cast, past or present, as the main like character in your film?
You know, a lot of actors, especially after they've been acting a long time, they want to make their own movie. And I was talking to an actor colleague who's got a very successful acting career. He just directed his first movie and loved it. I directed on Voyager and had a great time, but I just didn't feel it was for me. I felt I liked being an actor more. So I don't. I have pitched stories for movies. I have a horror movie idea where Ethan Phillips and I would play these old vaudevillians, and part of the movie takes place in the past and part in the present. But I don't really know. I mean, if you're asking who I would like to direct or produce or who I would like to act opposite, you know, if I'd like to be in the movie, it's kind of a tough question because I really don't fantasize about making my own movies anymore because it's so hard to do, you know. I have pitched ideas in the past. We developed stuff, and then it's a long game. Some movies that come out that are so successful, you find out that somebody's been nursing that project for 14 years or whatever until it finally gets made. But you know, that's what often that kind of passion is what makes something really unique and different. And I thought our Academy Awards this year really. You know, this wonderful movie, Moonlight, you know, it's great that they credit a relatively small budgeted movie about sort of a difficult subject and reward it. I think it's good that we're, you know, I know, because a lot of the money in American movies goes to the blockbuster movies because they're pre-sold and everybody knows you're not going to lose. If you make another Star Wars movie, you're never going to lose money, even though it costs so much to make it. But it's kind of cut out, the middle class movies seem to have disappeared. There's either real low budget movies that are $4 million and under, and then there's movies that cost $180 million. But the old days, they used to make sort of middle budget movies, which are not really done anymore. It's kind of funny, where the movie was $14 million or $26 million or something. It's either like huge and expensive or everything. And what that means is for the actors working in the little ones, nobody gets paid. Everybody gets paid scale. So the sort of middle class movies and middle class careers as actors are being squeezed down out of the movie business and television. It's a different story. But there's so many things to watch on television now. I can't believe you guys are here. 3,000, you know, there's so many great shows that are on TV now. That's where a lot of the most exciting work is happening.
But you wound up on a Star Trek movie anyway, so.
I was in one of the Star Trek movies. You remember my brief moment in First Contact? You remember that, when the doctor is used as sort of a doorstop? The doctor is used as a... Would you like to hear the story of how that came about? Because that's a cute... I had been in Rick Berman's office, as we were just speaking about directing. I had been in Rick Berman's office, our producer. Talking about directing, because I was in, you know, he had a policy that if you kind of went to school on the show and spent a certain number of hours trailing other directors and going to the editing bay, that he would give you shot directing, and I think I was about to get my first shot, like, right around then, I don't remember, but maybe a year later I got to direct, but I was already pursuing studying being a director, as were Roxanne, Robbie, and Tim. And I'm leaving his office, and I knew, because I'd seen Generations, the handoff movie between the original cast and the next gen, they destroy the Enterprise on the ice planet at the end of the movie. So I knew the Enterprise didn't exist anymore. And I said, you're gonna have a brand new Enterprise in your next feature. And he said, yes. I said, you know, I don't understand something. Why does Voyager have more advanced technology than your flagship? He said, what do you mean? I said, well, how come we've got this emergency medical hologram thing and the Enterprise doesn't happen? I said, I'm not trying to pad my part, I'm just looking out for your logic. And he smiled and said, why would they look alike? I said, why wouldn't they look alike? It's like a popular screensaver. It's the first generation of a program. They would all be identical. And he smiled and said, that's a very interesting idea. And I thought, okay.
The seed had been planted.
A week or two later, I'm having dinner with Ron Moore over at his house, because I was friendly with Ron, even though he didn't really work on Voyager then. He wrote some scripts for it, but he was primarily on Deep Space Nine. But I knew that he and Brannon were writing the script for First Contact. So I was with Ron, and I said, you and Brannon are writing the... He said, yeah. I said, you know, I didn't understand something. I walked him down the path. And he said, that's a very interesting idea. A week or two later, I'm in Brannon's office, we're talking about something for the doctor, and I said, you and Ron are writing a new script. I said, you know, I didn't understand something. I walked him down the path, and he said, that's a very interesting idea. Okay, now like 2 months go by, and I'm on a break shooting in my trailer, shooting Voyager, and I get a phone call from Jonathan Frakes, and he said, I just wanted to thank you for helping me get to direct the next Star Trek feature. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, the episode that was entirely the Doctor, the first one I directed on your show, is called Projections, I think, where the Doctor thinks he's real. Barclay's in it, and Barclay's trying to convince the Doctor that he's a real person in a holographic simulation, and everybody else is hologram. Jonathan directed that. It was a very popular show, and the producers gave him approval. In other words, the feature side of Paramount, the feature side of the studio, had to approve this TV guy, mm-hmm. even though he was going to be in the feature. They had to approve him as a director, and that's how he got approved. And I said, that's very, very gracious of you, but I'm sure you got the job, you know, on your own merits. I said, but you know, I don't understand. And I told Jonathan the whole story. He went, that is a very interesting idea. And about 3 weeks later, Rick Berman called me on the phone and said, we decided to put the EMH in the next Star Trek feature. And I said, that's a very interesting idea. Question, the way you framed it. I mean, I've been asked, what was it like to work on Star Trek versus Stargate? But Stargate was like a gift. It just came my way. I didn't have to work for it. In Star Trek, I had to go through the audition process twice, and frankly, I worked really hard on that show. We all did. So I feel like I kind of earned that experience, because it was a lot of work. I made a lot of suggestions. Brannon Braga does a terrific impression of me, where back then Brannon was still smoking, and he would sneak out of the writer's office for a cigarette, and he does an impression of me jumping out of the bushes going, you know, Brannon, I was thinking. Which is probably true. I probably did that. I made a lot of suggestions to the writers on Star Trek. And some of them they loved, and some of them they didn't, and some of them they used, and some of them they didn't. But a number of them, probably the best one, was my relationship with Seven of Nine, because I was concerned that when Kes left the show, because Kes had been the Doctor's confidant, I thought without the Doctor's sounding board there anymore, then the Doctor would go back to being just a joke again, just a windbag. Because I love playing a windbag, but what was fun about it was that I revealed a different side of the character to this young assistant I had in sickbay, who ostensibly I was mentoring her in how to be a medical assistant, but she was really mentoring me in my developing, you know, humanity, so to speak. So when Kes was going away, I said, I really, nobody else, I've never spoken to anybody. It's a little bit to Janeway, but not really anybody else in the crew. I've never really revealed the Doctor's other side to. And he said, well, we're adding a character, Seven of Nine. Why don't you think of a way that your character can relate to Seven of Nine? And I, meanwhile, saw Jerry Ryan, and I could think of a number of ways we all did. It didn't seem appropriate. But I thought about it, and I went back, and I said, okay, I think I have it. What if we turn the mentoring relationship around that the Doctor had with Kes, and the Doctor now thinks that he's the best teacher of how to be human, even though he's not human? Because I thought that appealed to all of the Doctor's pomposity and his over-evaluation of himself, but left plenty of opportunity for him to still be a buffoon and could have touchy moments. And I specifically said we could have role-playing exercises where she learns how to behave appropriately in various situations now that she's re-entering, you know, leaving the hive and re-entering regular, you know, crew life. And they did it. I mean, that one arc carried on basically for 4 years. We had shows that were with scenes about, you know, that, or we would just refer to her development and what we might be next for her to work on. And it culminated in the episode "Someone to Watch Over Me," where the Doctor falls in love with his pupil. Mm-hmm. So that was, I think, that was the best suggestion I made, because it ended up giving me all these wonderful scenes with Jerry and the audience, you know, because it was kind of heartstring tearing at the end. So on Star Trek, I guess what I'm saying is that I didn't know what I had gotten into. I didn't know enough about Star Trek. I've confessed to the fan base long ago that I was not a fan when I was cast, but I have confessed it. Must say to the feet of the faithful, I have thrown myself into mercy, and I have been saved by Eugene.
Thank you, Gene.
I now understand. I understand why the show means what it does to you, and I'm very conversant in Star Trek now. I know a lot. But when I got the part, I didn't know a lot, so I had no idea that I had aced the best role in the show. I thought I had gotten the worst role in the show. I mean, I have five friends, at least, that I said, I was cast on a new Star Trek series. I know it's a really good job because it'll run 7 years and I'll put my kids through college. But I have the worst part on the show. And then I had to live that down, because it turned out I was not only wrong, I didn't have the worst part, I had the best part on the show, arguably. The other actors, because I had the longest arc, I started with nothing, so I got to grow into something, but I didn't understand. I didn't get that that's what they were going to do, because I didn't understand Star Trek to realize that I was the outsider character. I thought it was going to be Tuvok. I thought Tuvok, oh, he's the Vulcan, he'll be that role. But really, the Doctor, until Jerry Ryan joined us, for the first 3 years, the Doctor was the, you know, he was the Data, but totally different from Data. That was the other thing I was concerned about. I thought, oh my God, everybody loves Data, and I'm the next artificial intelligence, they're all going to hate me. But he was so, the writers had conceived him so differently, as a curmudgeon rather than as Pinocchio, as a curmudgeon. And also, Data was limited until the movies by not having any emotion. And the Doctor had these primitive, you know, emotional subroutines that were designed give him a bedside manner with his patients, but in fact, didn't really work. And the Doctor was, early on in Voyager, the Doctor was much more concerned about how he felt than how you felt. Right? So That was an amazing arc, and I can't compare Stargate. I'm getting back to your question, believe me. The difference is that Stargate was really a sporadic thing for me until they made me a regular character. I was a recurring guest star. In fact, I was hired to do one show only, one show. Heroes in season 5, they had written this great episode with Solomon Kinnick guest starring, and the show was 9 minutes too long, so they went to the network and said, we would like to turn this into a two-parter. Why don't we turn the second half of Heroes into our clip show? Because Stargate would do a clip show every season where they mined the previous season for exciting sequences, and they wrote a new story about it. And that way, that show was done for half the budget of a regular episode. That was a fairly standard thing they did. So they needed filler material. And when you think filler material, I was brought in simply to be a bridge character so they could do flashbacks. Mm-hmm. And I'm interviewing the whole... This is right after Dr. Keller has died.
Yeah.
Keller or Kellner? Keller.
Keller,
I'm correct. Dr. Keller's died, and I'm there to assign blame for this tragedy. I'm somebody's head's gonna roll. So Mr. Woolsey was really a very unlikely character. No personality. Raw. And I had so many lines. I had like 14 pages of dialogue to shoot in one day, and the shots were complicated. There was one scene where they kept going around me, interviewing, and every time the camera went around and came back on me on the interviewee chair, the person changed. Well, what that means is those actors were sliding in and out under the camera in front of me, and I could never, your eye can never flicker from where they're supposed to be because you destroy the illusion. And that long tape with a lot of lines in it, they loved me because I got all the work done quickly. And the producer, Joe Malazzi, who I'm still very good friends with, in fact, I'm going to have dinner with him this weekend, he just decided, because they liked me on Voyager, but he didn't know that he would like working with me so much. So they had painted themselves in a corner by making me a total douchebag. And then he goes, we want to have this guy back. So every time they would have him back, I would have one tiny, tiny improvement in my character. I was a total douchebag. Then I was a total douchebag who really believed in government oversight of secret operations. So I was a total douchebag who meant well. The next time I'd be a total douchebag who meant well and knew that he was a douchebag. And then the next time I'd be a total douchebag who meant well, who knew he was a douchebag, who really wished he wasn't a douchebag. So every time I had another little something that came back that made him more human. And then finally, right before Thanksgiving in 2006 or whatever, I get a call from Joe Malazzi saying, we'd like you to be the new commander of the Atlantis expedition. I said, great. I'm a complete douchebag. Everybody hates me, or they feel sorry for me. I have no people skills. I have no command skills. All I do is tell other people what they're doing wrong. I'm a coward. I run away from danger faster than anyone else. He said, don't worry, those are our problems. I said, great, I'll do it. And they rehabilitated that character. They kept, they made the audience really start to like me. They were very clever with those little things they gave me to do, like when I can't get out of the briefing room, right after I take it, before I can get the door to work. They gave me really sweet things to do so the audience would start to root for me. And beyond that, I love the fact that, in our world now, where it's so rapidly changing and technology changing, there are a lot of people in middle age. Well, at this time I was 10 years younger. So here I am, a guy, in my early, I was 10 or 12 years ago when I joined the show, but I'm in my early 50s, and I'm suddenly trying to redefine myself, to take, instead of being the armchair quarterback, I'm trying to play the game. Instead of me critiquing your work, I'm trying to do your job. And that was a bold thing to do, and I liked that arc, and I think people, especially middle-aged people, responded to a guy who was like trying to make himself into a leader at a late moment in his career. He's trying to learn how to do something completely different from the inside out. And that's what made it fun for me to play. And that's why I was really happy when people said by the end of that season, and I know Stargate ended very precipitously, we all hope we had another year, but by the end of that, Woolsey had really grown into a leader, and that's cool. That was a very long-winded answer. But with that, Robert, we want to say thank you. Seriously, it was a very enjoyable evening. I want to thank everybody for coming out. And let's hope that somebody wants to thank you. Just say hello if you want to grab paper. You don't have to buy anything because I know a lot of you already have my pictures. You can still say hello. And now I'm going to a photo op now with that problem that never goes away. My shiny head. May you baldly go.